As we said earlier, RVM has to be efficient, as otherwise no one will use it. The runtime does not actually write the persistent data that is specified through the setRange call directly to the external data segments. Instead, it writes the changes that it made to the block of addresses specified by the setRange call as a redo log in a log segment that was named in the initialized call. And we know that the log segment is the trick that we mentioned earlier also to avoid random writes to the disk. The log segment is an in-memory data structure of the RVM runtime, and once a transaction commits, at that point, the log segment that contains the changes that have been made to the in-memory version of persistent data structures will be committed to the disk. Or in other words, RVM writes the changes that the developer is making to persistent data structures in between begin and end transaction as redo logs in the log segment. And these redo log that has been written into the log segment is committed to the disk at the point of end transaction. On the other hand, if the transaction aborts, then you don't have to commit those redo logs to the disk. Now remember that the changes that have been made to the persistent data structures, the in-memory versions of those persistent data structures, have to be eventually committed to the external data segments. Now that part is done lazily by the RVM system. It basically applies the redo logs that have been committed to the disk to the external data segments at opportune moments. And once it has applied those redo logs from the log segment into the external data segments, the redo logs can be thrown away. And this part is what is called truncation. So there are two parts to managing the log. One is at the point of commitment, the log has to be forced to the disk because you want to persist it. And second, once it has been committed to the disk, you have to eventually apply it to the external data segments, and at that point, you can truncate the log. So the log is going to be applied to the external data segments, and once those external data segments have been modified, then you can throw away those redo logs. So flushing the log segment to the disk, as well as truncating the log segment once they have been applied to the external data segments that they represent, are all done automatically by LRVM. So the application developer doesn't have to do anything other than initialize his virtual memory, the log segment he wants to use, and write the code that contains these critical sections bound by begin transaction, an end transaction, or abort transaction. But RVM also provides flush and truncate as primitives for flexibility in writing the application. Or in other words, the application can, if it chooses, explicitly manage the persistence and application of the redo logs to the data segments. Shortly, we will mention some optimizations specified through the commit mode to the RVM library by the application programmer to enhance performance. One of those optimization features allows the RVM to defer flushing to the disk at the point of commit. So one of those optimization features in the commit mode is to tell the RVM, do not flush the changes to the log segment at the commit point yet. I'll take care of it explicitly by flushing. So these additional primitives are for the developers, if she so chooses, to explicitly controlling flushing of the logs to the disk and also manage the truncation of the logs by explicitly applying it when she wants it to the external data segments to conserve space. Because if you think about it, all these log segments are occupying space on the disk. At the commit point, you're flushing the redo records and the log segments to the disk. And so you're filling up the disk with a lot of redo records in addition to the external data segments. The truncation is a way by which the subsystem designer can explicitly say, go ahead and apply these redo logs to the external data segments and truncate the log. So as I said, these calls are there purely for flexibility if the designer so chooses to use these primitives for explicitly controlling and reducing the log space. And these additional primitives are available in RVM as a way by which the developer can administer the design of a subsystem and performance tune his subsystem for optimality. The main thing to take away is that the RVM design is simple with a small set of primitives, easy to grok for a developer and use in the design of a subsystem. Also, we've been using the word transaction, but the semantics of the transaction as used in RVM is much more restricted compared to the traditional use of the word transaction in the database literature. In particular, the transaction as proposed and used in the RVM library is intended for recovery management. It does not need all the properties that are usually associated with traditional transaction, so-called ACID properties, namely atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. For example, the transaction as defined in RVM does not allow for nested transactions. It has no support for concurrency control. So all of these are things that you normally associate with transaction, but the key design objective in RVM is to make it simple and performant and easy to use. And if there is need for concurrency control, it is something that the developer has to implement at a higher level in their system software. So in this sense, it is useful to remember what I said earlier, that the code that exists between begin transaction and end transaction is like a critical section in the application code. And all that the developer is trying to signal through that critical section to the RVM library is that it is making changes to a portion of an address range. And that portion of the address range, it needs to be persisted if, in fact, that critical section bound by this end transaction commits. On the other hand, if that critical section aborts, then those changes should be thrown away. That's the intent of the set of primitives provided by RVM, and that's the intent of this transaction semantic.